As you might have already noticed, this trend filtered into sports too. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of different sports disciplines practiced all over the world. Some of them will just leave you questioning the sanity of those who have invented them. Ranging from ridiculous and confusing to downright creepy and dumb, some sports just make no sense at all.
But I mean, I'm Mike with List 25,
and these are the 25 dumbest sports ever created.
Yeah.
25. Bog snorkeling. Invented in Wales in 1976, snorkeling is a sporting event that consists of competitors completing two consecutive lengths of a water-filled trench cut through a peat bog in the shortest time possible. Competitors must wear snorkels and flippers and complete the course without using conventional swimming strokes, relying on flipper power alone. 24. Okay. Crab racing. Crab racing is a serious sport in some Caribbean and Pacific Island countries. The crabs collected for the event, usually hermit crabs, are labeled with race numbers, and spectators can bet on the winner. Actually, there's even the National Crab Racing Association that was established in 1979. 23. Cheese rolling.
Yeah, but crab racing actually seems interesting. Now, snail racing, that's a whole new level. That's just like in SpongeBob, dude. That's what we want to see, snail racing.
Held annually at Cooper's Hill near Gloucester, England, cheese rolling is one of the oldest and most bizarre customs to have survived in the UK. This sporting event has been going on for hundreds of years. Some say it has its roots in pre-Roman times. Now a world-famous event, the contest is also notorious for how many people get seriously injured in it. 22. Chess boxing. A crazy hybrid of two completely different sports, chess boxing is exactly what it sounds like. A combination of chess and boxing. This unusual sport was brought to life in 2003 by Dutch artist Jeppe Rubing, who was inspired by a graphic sci-fi novel from 1992. 21. Shin kicking. One of the worst and most painful sports ever created, shin kicking is another bizarre sport that originated in the UK. Simply put, competitors hold on to each other and then kick each other's shins until one of them falls over. And yes, it's just as painful as it sounds.
20.
Car curling. If you consider curling a bizarre sport, you probably haven't heard of car curling.
These are all bizarre, but I'm just thinking right now, like, I gotta watch some of these. I kind of want to look some of them up right now. I'm wanting to watch some crab races, some car curling, some fucking shin kicking. Chess boxing's the one that makes me so confused. I'm like, I gotta see some You know what? We're gonna go look up some chess boxing right now. Right now, we're doing some chess boxing. You can never have too much. Chess box. I want to see, oh, dude, this is the champion, World Chess Boxing Championship. I go chess boxing and I get Wu-Tang Clan. I mean, it is called the mystery of chess boxing. They know what it is. They know the secrets. Give me this. What's chess box? About to watch the clothes go at.
Pittsburgh belt gathered up. There are fights at three weights, organized by the World Chess Boxing Organization. This is Nikolai Sashin, just 19 years old. A keen chess player and a good amateur boxer, he's a math student at the Russian College for Space Travel in Krasnoyarsk, Siberia.
See, that's the thing that makes it so interesting, is that it's not just, oh, they're strong and they gotta punch each other. It's, oh no, they're strong and they're smart as hell as well. It's like, yeah, he's a math man, but he can also throw those hands, you know? Be good, catch some hands.
And he is up against Frank Stolt, a Berlin policeman and world chess boxing champion. Frank has already had 6 chess boxing fights. It'll be his experience against Nikolai's youth.
Okay, I'm ready for this.
This is an international sport and an international competition. First come the national anthems. And now it's time to explain how chess boxing works.
Yeah, I need to know.
A chess boxing contest is fought over 11 rounds.
11
6 rounds of chess and 5 3-minute rounds of boxing. The chess match is played against the clock, with each player having 12 minutes to make his moves. The contest starts with a 4-minute chess round. Then the players pull on the gloves for a 3-minute round of boxing, fought according to amateur rules.
That's a lot of chess.
The contest proceeds with alternating rounds of chess and boxing. A fight is decided either through a knockout in the ring or by checkmate on the chessboard. Or, of course, if one of the two opponents runs out of time on his chess clock. If the chess results in a drawn game, then the overall contest is...
See, but these are not like... Like, chess is getting pretty big on Twitch. These aren't like the super intense, like, Grandmaster 3-minute chess rounds that they do. Because they're doing like 12-minute chess rounds. Unless if I get that wrong and they're saying, oh, the chess rounds in total would equal 12 minutes, and then therefore 3-minute chess rounds. But it's just funny to watch these guys in their boxing outfits just... Okay, we gotta do chess. Then I'm about to beat your ass once I beat you in chess, dog. I beat you on the board, then I'm gonna beat you in the ring. Well, they're doing the ring and doing the board in the ring, so.
It's decided on points in the ring.
Okay, he's making his moves.
And here we are in the opening chess round.
I forgot who was who.
Both men are being careful. And avoiding the risk of giving his opponent an opening.
Just all these people come for boxing and they're like, shit, he just moved his king up there. He's like, oh no, he just did some castling. Dude, I don't know if he's going to be able to beat that castling though. Did you see him move his knight to b4? That's going to mess him up in the rest of the round. It's going to mess him up. This doesn't, like, the arena does not look good for being able to watch the chess match. Unless they have, like, monitors that people are watching it on.
Just like in boxing. Sashin has opened with a queen's gambit.
A queen's gambit already.
Frank chooses the Slav defense.
Oh, the Slav defense?
I don't know. Those are not head guards, but head sets. Designed to blank out the running chess commentary provided for the audience.
Wait, was that it?
Then it's time to put away the chessboard. Each man now becomes his own fighting pawn as the gloves go on.
Wait,
and the ring is clear.
Wait, what? We didn't even finish the chess match. Wait, I'm so confused. So it's alternating between the chess match and boxing? Oh, this is even worse than I thought. So they do the chess, then you start fucking beating each other up, and then they're back on chess. So it's gonna look even goofier when they're beating up, playing chess, like... Got you in check.
For man-to-man battle.
Oh, let's see this. Let's see them throw some hand. Oh, wow, they moved that board fast.
Just as they did at the chessboard. The two men are being careful, feeling each other out.
Okay.
The first attack comes from Nikolai, who crosses with his right hand catches Frank with a glancing blow to the chin.
So I wonder
Nikolai
how
continues
good they
to
are
show
at
more
each.
Aggression. While Frank is clearly wary of his younger opponent, and finally goes into a clinch.
Like, I would want to see them in, like, just a normal boxing
match. But Nikolai continues to press forward.
People who just do boxing, and then them doing, like...
And he catches Frank
like, playing chess
with a
like,
left hook and a straight.
Or people that, like, are professional
The referee
chess
checks
players.
He's okay to continue, but Frank's wife looks concerned as her husband takes 3 more heavy blows.
Are like, amazing for at all both, his experience, or is he just, like, Frank they're can't good avoid enough the leads both.
From his younger opponent.
Look at that.
Nikolai tries to pin Frank into the corner, but Frank shows his experience and boxing skills to ooh, turn the ooh, tables on Nikolai and gets in a few punches of his own. Frank has survived the second round, the first with the gloves on, but it's clear that Nikolai is ahead on points.
Why did I miss?
The two boxers have a minute to recover, to take off the gloves and to focus on their kings and queens on the board.
Okay, so with the adrenaline a minute of pumping chest through and then, like, their bodies, a minute the big of challenge boxing? Is
to keep cool and avoid easy mistakes on the board. Nikolai keeps up the pressure on the chessboard as well as in the ring, with a dude, pawn attack Nikolai. On Frank's Nikolai, queen he's a man side. On
the chessboard.
Frank responds with a stonewall defense.
What's them gloves? Come on, he's trying off. To set up he's an there.
Attack on Nikolai's king side, but he's Frank's defense has left his pieces time. Cramped with little room for maneuver.
Just what I want from my boy Nikolai.
Nikolai has a more open position.
My goodness.
Both players are taking their time, avoiding stupid mistakes in the first chess round.
It's just, like, alternating between them so fast. Like, you're trying to recover from the boxing, you're like, but then you have to, like, be thinking about the chess match, so you can't think about recovering, you gotta think about the chess moves that you gotta make. And then, I wonder when they move from the chessboard, are they thinking about the moves that they're gonna make in chess, or are they just thinking about the boxing? Like, is Nikolai going, ooh, he just moved his knight in front of my bishop, like, what am I supposed to do? Or, he just moved his bishop near my knight. My knight seems like he's in the open. Where am I going to be able to move him so I can make sure I can get to that king faster? And also, maybe kill his queen. Like, are they thinking about that while they're throwing punches? Or are they just being professional and alternating between the two? Just thinking one thing straight. Like, goddamn, dude, this is intense. This is...
After 3 minutes of boxing...
This is what they need to do on Twitch. Chess boxing. I need all the grandmasters out there fucking playing chess and then boxing right after.
Back in the ring, and Nikolai is once again on top. He's seeking out gaps in Frank's defense.
Ooh, yes, yes, and yes, finding them. The gaps in just Frank.
But with Frank's gloves oh, yeah, held okay, high, yeah, Nikolai Frank soon decides it's time to start working on the body.
Nikolai's been in the game. Frank's a newbie. What's that? What's that kid supposed
first,
to
he softens Frank up with a right to the kidneys ooh, and follows that yeah. up with a sharp hook to the liver.
Oh, Nikolai,
which makes on. Frank gasp for breath.
Come on, Nikolai, you got
Nikolai
this.
Nikolai knows he's got Frank hurt and tries to press home his advantage with more lefts and rights and combination punches.
Come on.
The referee Nikolai's separates the boxers and warns Frank to keep his head up.
Yeah, come on. But
Frank
Nikolai,
isn't finished by a long way.
Wait, is Nikolai
and bloodies
kid?
Nikolai's nose with I a totally right to the face. But a few drops of blood
yeah,
don't
damn.
Stop the Russian.
Yeah, damn, he's bleeding. Oh my goodness, dude, look at this. Come on, show him. Show him, Nikolai. Come on, show Frank. Show Frank what you got. Oh my goodness. Wait,
both men are showing signs of battle, but it's clear Nikolai has also taken the fourth round on points.
Oh my goodness, they're both thief. I mean, one worse than the other, but...
In the fifth round, stamina will be the key.
I know, dude,
Frank
now
is still
even
feeling
worse
the
with
effects
the
of some sickening blows to the body, and his black pieces are facing multiple threats, including one that he's totally missed.
Oh, damn.
Nikolai
dude,
withdraws
Nikolai's
his knight to reveal
fronts.
A double attack on Frank's bishop and queen. And what do you know? He doesn't see that his queen can be taken.
Oh.
After Nikolai's body shots, this is the killer body blow.
Oh, Nikolai.
The Russian takes Frank's queen. Frank knows he's beaten and gives up the fight.
Damn, Nikolai. Okay, Nikolai was the younger guy.
Chess
I mean,
boxing
no.
has a new world champion. Nikolai Sashin.
Frank was the older
he came
guy,
a long way from Siberia for this fight.
Frank was the younger guy, Nikolai.
And he's taken the belt back home with him.
Yeah, woo!
Frank Stolt was obviously disappointed.
He had the brains in.
Come on, him.
Look, I gave it all I've got. It wasn't that I didn't want to fight on. But you know, when you've lost your queen, there's no point.
Isn't there, though?
In the ring itself, he applied a lot of pressure, and that put out my fire, to be honest.
Wait, but isn't there ways to come back when you lose your queen? I know that the queen's very important. But, like, I would think that a beginner would think, oh, if I lose my queen, I'm done for. And a pro, like a chess master, would be like, oh, I lost my queen. I can get him back, though. Because you just have to take out the enemy's queen and then make it even. But I don't know how far down Frank was, obviously. I mean, they made it seem like Nikolai was very far ahead in the chess game. I mean, Nikolai just had him on all corners. Frank had nothing. He had nothing. All he had was his youth. His youth, and that was it. Nikolai was there. He's a pro. He's won 9 times in the chess boxing championships. What's Nikolai going to do? I mean, what's Frank going to do? Frank, he's just too young. He'll get better by time. Frank will be the next Nikolai. He'll be able to top that 10-streak World Box Championship belt. Even though this is part 1 of 2, what is the second part then?
Honest, did you get the feeling he was a better boxer, but that you hoped to make up for that at the chess? Yeah, he put me under a lot of pressure in the boxing. I got through a few times, didn't seem to have any effect. Very impressive. Was it your plan to go on the attack in the ring and to play safe on the board? Yeah.
You know what? For how stupid the concept is, I'm kind of into this. This is actually... I can see why people watch this. It's ridiculous, but... It seems like a comedy sketch, though. Because the interviews would seem ripe with, like, just comedic gold of, like... So, you thought about in the chess match, you thought about going on all in the offense, but then you did a lot of defense in the boxing. Like, what was that? Well, you know, I'm just more of a pro at chess, and I'm not that good at boxing. What can I say? I don't know what that was supposed to be. I wonder if there is... Is there a way to do it to where... I guess you have to be competent at chess, but... If you were that good at boxing, like, amazing, and won every round of boxing, would you be able to, like, flub the chess a bit? I guess I don't know how their scoring system works.
My aim was to put him under so much pressure in the ring that he'd make mistakes in the chess.
That's a good strat. You know what? See, this has a whole new way.
And then it was time to announce the official result.
See, this is what we need on Twitch. The next Pog Champs is chess boxing, right here, right now. I want to see the biggest Twitch champions go in chess boxing.
Nikolai Sashin.
But I mean, only when COVID's
lifted. That followed the fifth round resignation of Frank Stott.
Man, you know what? That was well worth it. That was well worth it. I'm glad I watched that. Okay, let's get back to these ridiculous sports, though. Even though I kind of want to watch crab racing. I also want to watch car curling.
In Russia, car curling is very similar to the original sport.
So many video ideas.
However, there are two
innovations.
You use cars instead of the granite stones, and real humans instead of the brooms.
19.
Okay.
Toe wrestling. In toe wrestling, the two competitors sit opposite each other with their feet on a board, lock toes, and try to force their opponent's foot down. It's the best of 3 rounds. The best part? Each round is known as a toe down. Unsurprisingly, this sport was invented in the UK.
Yo, 18. You ready to toe down?
Mountain unicycling, aka Muni.
Come on.
As if riding a unicycle wasn't hard enough, someone came up with the idea of riding it up
fantastic.
And down a mountain. Mountain unicycling events recognized by the International Unicycling Federation are cross-country, uphill and downhill, with the possibility of North Shore downhill.
17.
Extreme ironing. Extreme ironing is an extreme and extremely...
Yo, I'm about to do some extreme ironing, yo. Yo, heading up the mountain for some extreme ironing. You want to come? Dude, I need this. Dude, this is... Okay, now... Sounds like something my mom would make up. Come on. only because of the gender roles. But hey, you know what? That's how you get men into irony. No, yeah, that was it. That was it. It was a trick to get men into ironing. They're like, yo, extreme ironing. That's what you gotta do now. You gotta call everything extreme. Extreme vacuuming. Men will start vacuuming. They'll start buying all them Dysons. And then you'll have top brands. It'll be insane.
Weird sport in which people take ironing boards to crazy locations and iron items of clothing. The sport has taken place in many bizarre places. These include on a mountainside, in a canoe, on a sea bottom, and while parachuting.
Sea bottom and 16. While parachuting?
Cheese rolling. Held annually at Cooper's Hill near Gloucester, England, cheese rolling is one of the oldest and most bizarre customs to have survived in the UK. This sporting event has been going on for hundreds of years. Some say it has its roots in pre-Roman times.
Didn't we?
Now a world-famous event, the contest is also notorious for how many people get seriously injured in it.
15.
Ferret legging. What? In ferret legging, competitors tie the bottoms of their pants closed, drop a ferret down the pants, and close the top tightly with a belt. You can imagine what an angry ferret with sharp teeth and claws trapped in a pair of pants can do.
I would not. This sport
became a popular competition among coal miners in Yorkshire, England in the 1970s. I just
know my privates
14.
Would not feel good.
Underwater hockey.
Ooh.
Also known as octopush, which sounds like Sean Connery.
Hockey was intense, underwater hockey now. That's where it's at. That's where it gets dirty. It's where it gets rough. You might see some swim trunks come off. They come off the field. You get to see some cheeks. Some sweet cheeks.
Octopus. Underwater hockey is a limited contact sport invented by the British Navy in the 1950s. It was created to keep their divers fit and to improve their ability to move and work efficiently underwater. The game came to Australia shortly after. It has evolved into a dynamic sport played in more than 20 countries.
13.
Wow. 20 countries.
Belly flopping.
Okay, see.
Belly flopping is a...
See, that's not strange. Come on. Just because people take it extreme belly flopping. That's what
Norwegian
that.
Sport, where the normal fear you get when diving becomes the goal. Competitors have to jump from a 10 meter or 33 foot height with their bodies as stretched out as possible. They curl into a ball immediately before hitting the water. The diver who stays in the flat position the longest wins.
Oh, but so you have to is be it flat really the winning longest? Though?
12.
Kite tubing. Kite tubing is a sport in which a large inflatable device is used to let people fly behind a motorboat in a way similar to water skiing. It's actually even more dangerous than it looks. There have been several deaths associated with this sport.
11.
Cricket spitting.
This cool.
delightful sport was developed in 1996 by entomologist Tom Turpin at Purdue University in West Lafayette, Indiana. Cricket spitting is a sport in which contestants put a dead cricket in their mouth and then spit it as far as they can.
Ew.
10.
Okay, that's just nasty. Why would I ever want to do that?
The World Pea Shooting Championship has been held annually since 1971 in the village of Witcham near Ely in Cambridgeshire, England. The competition tends to be dominated by local competitors, though a small number travel from around the world, most notably the U.S.
9.
Worm charming. The practice of coaxing earthworms from wet dirt can be found all over the world, usually as a method of collecting bait for fishing.
Worm charming.
However, in England, they've turned it into a sport discipline.
Real stuff.
The World Worm Charming Championships has been held annually here since 1980. The wormers are given a little square of land to fiddle, grunt, and charm their way to glory by collecting more worms than anyone else.
8.
Why?
Limbo skating.
What the?
Limbo skating is a sport in which a person drives on roller skates underneath a horizontally placed obstacle without touching it.
This is the sport insane.
Is very popular
some of
in
take
India,
extreme
particularly
skill
among
and you're
kids.
Like, oh, they're ridiculous.
Some are able to limbo skate under poles that are just 23 centimeters or 9 inches above the ground.
7.
Buzkashi. Literally translated as goat pulling, Buzkashi is a brutal Central Asian sport in which horse-mounted players attempt to place a headless goat carcass in a goal. It's the national sport of Afghanistan. However, it was banned during the Taliban regime. Buzkashi matches are usually very fierce and can last for up to several days.
Yeah, six. It looks fierce.
Bird chirping.
A headless
goat bird chirping carcass? Is a long-running and very popular sport in Suriname. The contests are all about testing a songbird's chirping power. Oh. Caged feathered competitors get a set amount of time to chirp as much as possible. The bird with the most chirps wins the match.
5.
Botaoshi. Supposedly invented as a part of training for the Japanese military, Botaoshi is a bizarre sport that looks like an extreme version of capture the flag.
Oh no, I've
every
seen
year,
this.
As a part of its induction ceremony, Japan's National Defense Academy has new cadets split up into two teams of 75 and play each other to control a pole.
No, I've seen that in an anime. I've seen it in a little thing called anime. Yeah, no, I've seen it in the one Reborn. You know, the one where the little baby shoots the dude. Yeah, that one.
4. Cardboard tube fighting.
Oh.
Most of us did some cardboard tube fighting.
You tell me this is real? Come on. This is just some people role playing. This can't be real. What? This is who outside of like the RP community thinks cardboard fighting? And I'm not saying like RP community as in like GTA RP or like Armor RP, like people that RP in real life, people that are out there in the streets RPing since day one, when it wasn't cool to do it in video games, when they're RPing with their cardboard, with their robes and elf ears, they're out there. Those are the OGs.
As kids, Robert Easley, a social worker from the San Francisco Bay Area, didn't want to abandon the cardboard fun as an adult. So what did he do? He founded the Cardboard Tube Fighting League. Tournaments and battles hosted by this now international organization are increasingly popular. The Cardboard Tube Samurai would be proud.
I mean,
3.
Yo.
Quidditch. Based on the fictional game of the same name featured in the Harry Potter series, Quidditch is a sport of two teams of 7 players. Each player is mounted on broomsticks played on a hockey rink-sized playing field. It's a weird mix of elements from rugby, dodgeball, and tag. Hufflepuff's the best house, hashtag better product.
2.
Rock, paper, scissors.
Okay, that rugby is just sadder than the cardboard tube fighting, I'll be honest here. Cardboard tube fighting, at least? It's kind of like sword fighting without an actual sword. The Quidditch one, I'm like, you're playing half the sport. Half of it's supposed to be in the air. You're on the ground. You can't. I wonder if there's like a vicious rivalry going on between the cardboard fighting community and the Quidditch community, thinking which one's lamer. Right, the Quidditch community is like, you guys are fucking lame. You guys playing with cardboard out there, like, boo-doo. And then the cardboard community is like, yeah, well, you're playing a sport that you're trying to act like you can ride a broom when you're just pulling it between your legs on the ground. Like, you guys look like idiots out there. What you gonna do, huh? Huh? Take it. You wanna fight about it? I got my cardboard right here. What you got? Your magic? Oh, wait, that don't exist. Owned.
The rules are well known. Scissors cuts paper, paper envelops rock, and rock smashes scissors.
I know.
Traditionally a game of chance used to settle disputes, rock, paper, scissors is also a popular sport these days.
How can you play
Las Vegas even hosts an annual rock, paper, scissors world championship.
1.
Oh my Jesus.
Dwarf tossing.
Okay, this is where we stop it. There's nothing fun that we can get from that. Okay, we watched some chess boxing. Now let's watch some, No.
Do I know how to spell curling? I don't. Good job, Moses. Oh.
Velkommen hit til Vålerbanen, gutter, og det første norske offisielle løpet I bilcurling. Dere jo selvfølgelig kjempegod
på bil. Det like you could only play in, like, somewhere where it's cold. I mean, obviously, like, Ogasha, it seems like the best place it would be. Let's see if they can make it.
Her kommer han.
Oh, let's see if you can do this. Go for the bullseye, baby. Oh, he's drifting right into that thing. Oh, he might have done it too soon. Oh, no. Oh, no. He's still going. He's still going. Oh. He made it too far past.
Golden plejer ikke å være spesielt
god damn. He should have learned from Fast and Furious. Should have watched some of that.
Yeah, du gjør.
Put that e-brake too late. Wait, so is there like a certain speed that you have to hit?
Hvorfor stoppa da?
Like, you have to drive a certain miles per hour? They missed it again.
Hei, hei, hei!
Er jeg foran?
Ja, nærmere!
Du får ikke noen poeng hvis du utenfor!
Faen!
Den ligger veldig riktig der oppe. Hold den bilen rett, og så det.
Like, because I think that...
Ja, den fin!
If you go slow enough, you'd be able to hit it.
Oi, oi, oi! Hold skal du gjøre!
Was this like for a talk show? Like, to just point this video for a live audience, be like, look at this ridiculous sport. Oh. Wow, he just helped the blue team. Yeah, because now the blue. Wait, you only get the point if it's in the bullseye.
Han klarer ikke ta det med ro.
Oh, come on.
For forsiktig.
No, that's not current war. Do your points just if it's in the circle, okay? Oh, yeah, because it's round.
We go for takeout.
Okay, yeah, I forget. So then whatever cars are still in the circle after that round of, like, cars. Then. Oh, look at this. Okay, now he's going too fast. Yeah, no.
Han er jo airbag! Kokker han ut!
Du skulle sette ut ikke
ut av det uten å nærme deg bilen. I want to watch a joke video. What? Oh, go, go! Yeah, that's like a whole team. Wait, last time we just saw one person in a car doing it. They had a whole team pushing it. Look at that, whole team is pushing these cars. Okay, so that makes more sense than to push it in neutral and do it. Than to, like, hit the gas and then hit the e-brake. I wonder if they like pick who's gonna be in the car to be like, yo, you don't hold down this car to make it go slow. Or you might want to put the lightweight person to make it go faster. Wow, these are big teams. My goodness, though. Ooh, that's an intense sport. I don't know if I can handle it. Ooh. I would love to actually watch more curling. No. No. I guess we're watching this. Gonna watch your roller boiner do what? 36 cars or something? 39 cars. And watch him. I mean, holy, what the fuck?
Balanced just inches from the floor, this tiny 6-year-old is taking the limbo skating world by storm.
Oh my Jesus, fuck.
Oh, he's got a mad head of hair.
Now Gagan Satish from Karnataka near Bangalore is waiting to be like confirmed the world's best.
Good. Oh, dude, that would be such
skating
an uncomfortable position to hold.
ಇಷ್ಟು ಮುಂದೆ ಬಂದು ಇಷ್ಟು ಒಂದು ಅಚೀವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾನೆ ಇನ್ನು ಮುಂದೆ ಮುಂದೆ ಅಚೀವ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವನಿಗೆ ಏನು ಸಹಾಯ ಬೇಕಾಗುತ್ತೋ ನಾವು ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ
Gagan took up the sport after his parents, like Hema and Regina like really Satish, bought him a pair of skates for his third birthday.
I wonder if he
soon displayed natural
talent.
Kept it
up. And hopefully his parents are not like pushing him to do more than
ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಅವನ ಬಾಡಿ ಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸಿಬಲ್ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ನಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಯ್ತು ಸೊ ಅವಾಗ ನಾವು ಲಿಂಬೋ ಸ್ಕೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ಅನ್ನಿಸ್ತು.
Hopefully it's just him actually wanting to do this.
Yes, I love skating.
Oh, okay.
Keen to develop his skills,
sounds like
Gagan's it's parents sought the advice of skating coach Yatish Gowda.
When Gagan meet me at the age of 3.5 years.
You guys met at the age of 3.5 years?
Young, and we rejected him. He's too young, we can't take this small kid.
But Gagan's parents were insistent. And now he trains for 2 hours each day under Yatish's
watch. 3.5 years old, this kid was already like,
today
yo, I want to roller skate. I want a limbo skate.
As he demonstrated his skills.
At 3.5 years, I was just like chewing on toys. Maybe pooping my diapers or something. I don't know what I was doing at 3.5.
In January this year, Gagan's 3-year dedication to the sport paid off when he skated a distance of 69.2 meters under 39 cars. The attempt, which is still under consideration by Guinness World Records, beat the previous record of 48.21 meters set by fellow Indian limbo skater Sheree Deshpande.
Oh my goodness.
Nearly 3 months he had practiced over there. After that,
dude,
in January 31st,
I would not. Oh, dude, I don't. No. I hate tight spaces, and that is too tight.
I break this world record.
And Gagan's skills have made him a local celebrity in the village.
He's a wonderful boy. He's very good. He's very talented in skating.
He may be waiting to become an official record holder, but Gagan is already setting his sights on new records and skating on the world stage.
I want to skate
under 100 cars. What? Dude, that's like almost 3 times what you just did. I wonder what he's doing now. Because, well, how long ago was this? This was
Oh my geez, this was 7 years ago. What? So this kid is now 13. I almost said 14. He's 13. He should be nearing 13 now. I mean, he's probably still 12. 12 to 13 now. Oh, no, I'm just going to assume 13. So he must be able to... I wonder if he kept it up. I wonder if he's still doing good. He must be able to do it very well. What else were you... Oh, crab racing. A hermit crab race? A blue crab race. Now I kind of don't really want to watch it. I don't feel like watching crab racing. No. No, that's just boxing. Ooh, we could watch some Shin fight. Ooh, yeah, Shin fighting. He's defending his title.
Fun Sport Friday, and we've got fighter. Some good old-fashioned shin kicking. This what, actually is old-fashioned. It's from the 17th
okay,
century.
Okay, wait, that's
here's
cheating.
Here's a semifinal
cheating.
Match between Babyface and the left here. A guy, oh, there's a wizard.
Wait,
I think he's
grass is
the
legal?
And here's a three-kick combo. He goes with the right, goes with the left, gets him off balance.
Okay, old man, get
him,
out of the way.
Bam, he's gone. Babyface moves on to the championship.
Oh,
that
Babyface is
on
the championship. Oh, wait, the guy's
really
the ref?
Uh-oh, here's the defending champion.
Ooh.
He comes out aggressive.
Ooh, dude, this
hard.
Is
why
a powerful
is the judge
chin
have a sword?
Kick.
Why
is
the guy got a sword?
Oh.
Anyway, he kills him. He hurts him. Listen to how this used to play. It was vicious in those days. There was a lot of inter-village rivalry, and lads used to harden their shins with hammers, and they were allowed to wear iron-capped boots. What the fuck? Are you serious? All right, here we go. This is the final match, Babyface versus the defending champ. He's got a good grip.
Oh, my goodness,
almost like
dude.
A hockey fight. Gets him down easily there. It's
my
more
goodness.
About holding the dude up than
Baby
dropping him when you get him off balance,
in.
I think. Here we go. Right leg there. Right kick there. Uh-oh, what are they doing? Wizards in the way. Belly's out. It's just really embarrassing
my
the baby face more. Okay,
goodness,
here we go.
Dude,
big
look,
kick there. Gets
dude,
him off
man.
Balance,
oh, my goodness.
Right.
Baby face is
uh-oh.
Like...
Okay, some haze.
Babyface's shirt is coming
there.
Off.
All right. Okay,
he's good going at
in the
this.
Way. Oh, can't see a fucking
like,
thing.
So does it matter how much...
Shirt's all the way up.
Because it seems like some people put more
man.
Grass in their pants
okay.
than others.
Wizard, please move. Please fucking move. And someone won. Okay, I think Babyface won. Here we go.
I actually
this
don't even know
Babyface
is
match.
His name.
Winner wins. Ooh, big swing and a miss.
Oh, my goodness.
Okay,
though. Ooh, dude, look at all that
oh,
grass.
That
was
kinda weak. I think the defending champ strategy...
Oh
is to get him moving backwards
whoa, whoa,
so they're a little
whoa,
more off balance. He's moving backwards. He's like, I got to stop this. Okay.
Wait, whoa, what
he's got to
counts...
go on the aggressive now.
I don't know what counts
he's
as a win.
He got to sweep the leg right after the other guy kicks because that's when he's off balance. There was
oh,
a
my
weird
goodness,
one.
Though.
Oh, these guys look really tired. Super tired. Look, oh, a little
oh,
twisty
my...
move. I like that. Left kick from the defending champ.
Yeah, because this is all just like leg moves.
Okay, nothing doing. Nothing doing. Tiring each other out.
I wonder how those like
oh,
karate women would do at this.
Big kick there, and he drops the baby face. He's like, oh, my God. Well, I tried
he
real hard.
Drops
defending
the
champ
damn.
Wins again. Shin kicking wins again.
Yeah, notice how it's all guys just everywhere there. No woman at all. Yeah, we already watched car curling. We're not watching toe fighting. Oh, mountain unicycling. That's what I'm wanting to watch.
there's always this association between the unicycle and the circus, and I couldn't be farther from being a performer. I like to pursue it for sport. You know, we started trail riding. It's once you get the hang of riding on the road, it gets monotonous. You get on the trail, and it's just so much more satisfying.
Dude, I just can't even. I can't master a unicycle ever.
Just a bunch of guys that really enjoy mountain unicycling. It's a very, very inefficient way to get around the woods.
You're working for every.
I guess I just like the risk.
Continuously
and
be
that
aware
danger
of every bump so that you
of,
can.
Ooh, I'm
for
gonna
it.
Fall.
After a while, you get a sense of what rocks you could actually ride over. You start pushing that further and further.
Oh, and. Yo, I listen to like legit fall. Ooh, but that dude made that turn.
A big, strong guy and rides big, strong ways. It's like a big chunk of meat running down the road.
Oh, my
Jack
Jesus.
Is amazingly fast.
Yeah, big, strong guys and big, strong ways.
I think I like to...
Dude, these are the alpha males of the world right
speed,
here.
So it can go mountain poorly unicycle. Very quickly. But more often than not, it works out.
Yeah, those losers on motorcycles? No. Those are betas. These are alphas right here. Which was
all out.
Look at these alphas.
I was close to being on my face.
And then me. I like going random ways off-road. I love going down steep things. I like going through stuff that doesn't
He likes the steep things. He's
like
they call him
like
the steep master. He's the downhill.
You got it, Russ. You got it, buddy.
Downhill master. I don't
this
know.
Is
I was
unicycle.
Trying to think of a nickname.
It's special because of the size of the tire and the amount of air that can be put in.
Oh,
that.
So they have a handle.
That tire is nice. It goes over rocks, sticks, mud.
I was like, why are they
sand.
Holding that area?
The handle is very important.
But it's
it
the
helps
handle.
To anchor your feet.
I guess that's
into the
how you
pedals.
Keep the balance.
It's got brakes. These are hydraulic. So unicycles do not coast. When you stop pedaling, the wheel stops.
Okay, so mounting a mountain unicycle, you want to make sure that your pedals are in the right spot.
Ooh,
so
those handlebars.
You want to give yourself a pedal that
those
you push
some man
down on
handlebars
it, it pushes
right
the unicycle
there.
Back underneath you.
Got no handlebars on his unicycle, but handlebars on his face.
When I was in college, a group of us all kind of learned how to unicycle together. We did get to the point where we were riding all over campus, you know, we'd ride.
Yeah, see, this is the youngin of the group.
Got a lot of attention, maybe not what
he's
we were
the next
for.
Generation mountain unicyclers.
Since I was 12, 40 years from today. I was ridiculed as a kid because of it. I mean, you know, kids find different things to pick on other kids about, and I didn't care. It was my thing. I go to work on my unicycle. I work at a federal facility and park it right out front. Everybody knows who I am.
They know you as the downhill master.
The hardest
downhill
thing is 10 hours of failure.
Pro downhill.
Falling on your face, literally.
I'm still thinking of the nickname.
It's a challenge.
Mr. Steep.
On a unicycle, at the
that's
very
what
last
call
minute,
Mr. Steep because he
might
goes
get
down steep hills.
Direction. Or worse yet, your pedal's not in the right spot. All of those things have to come together. And when they do, it's great. And when they don't, you fall. If you're not falling, you're not doing it right.
Oh. See, but these falls are actually not as bad as I thought they would be. Like, they all fall standing. Like, I thought they would, like, fall, like, flat on the side. But no, they actually don't fall that bad.
A certain type of person that
it's not like biking
to ride a unicycle. Like, you've got to be not afraid to look stupid and not worry about what people think of you. The group that I ride with, we do it just because we love it. It's the thrill and excitement of doing something that
you guys
you
get
didn't
made
know
fun of
do.
That much. That half this video is being like, yo,
well, you know,
don't think about
kind
what people
of it,
think
really
of you, man. Just mountain unicycle. Like, are people really making fun of you that much? That you feel like you have to say that you don't care about what people think. Kind of makes me think that you guys care that people think what people think of you. Okay. I forgot. I don't know why that's the thing. When you highlight, it doesn't just get rid of it. Extreme ironing. Oh wait, there's a world championships? Oh my lord, dude. Holy shit. This man's setting up right on the river. Oh. Oh. Dude, this dude's chill as fuck. He's like, hey, yo, you ain't got what I got, dog. He's like, look at the master. Oh, this dude's doing it upside down. What the fuck? He's showing it. He's showing off. Showing off so hard. Holy shit. What this doing it upside down. Off the back. That's the most redneck thing to do off the back of that. Okay, wait, how are you supposed to iron? This ain't that extreme. This is just stupid. Wait, we were doing it sitting down. Okay, this went from extreme to not extreme. You were doing it sitting down in the tube, now you're doing it standing up. See, look at this man. It's not as extreme as the upside down guy. You're lucky in the game. Wait, no, that is the upside down guy. No. See, this man, he's doing it not even holding the board. Oh, see, look at this dude. You got the master and the apprentice. This man, he's been doing it for years. See, this isn't extreme. Like, how you're not gonna top the dude that was sitting in the tube? Now, if the dude that could have done it on the paddleboard, he would have been it. I would have counted that as extreme. But this is like just weird. See, that man's just doing this standing up. The ironing area. Oh, see, this man. Now, this is extreme. This man doing it on a folding chair. On like a outdoor chair. Trying to set up the board. Just like right above the river. But he can't. Okay, see, this isn't extreme. This is just, what is happening? She's just doing it on a tree. This ain't that extreme. Is it unusual? Yes. Is it extreme? No. Okay, see, this man's doing it upside down. He's topping it already. If you got upside down in your factor, you're doing way better. Like, look at this man. And he lost. He lost it. He lost the ironing board. Oh no, he's losing it. I thought he mastered this for years. Now he's losing it. Again, you're just standing on a river. I mean, yes, is it unusual? Yes, is it? I came for extreme. I didn't come for just moderate. I didn't come for unusual ironing. I came for extreme ironing. This is just ironing at an inconvenience.
From Great Britain, Rose Britannia Ayers. Mannschaft 2.
Did all these people come for an ironing competition? And it's sponsored by Dave. At CA, I don't know who won. I don't know who that dude is. I don't know who he is from the video. I mean, you saw that. I see what look at that. That's kind of extreme.
Who will go to the ends of the earth.
Oh, see, this is what I call extreme. He's doing it under, they're doing it underwater. Danger.
But for many extreme sportsmen and women, nature itself does not present enough of a challenge. They're seeking something else, something more. and for an increasing number of them, that something is ironing. Extreme ironing has gained such a large following that it was decided this year to stage the first world championship, attracting athletes and media coverage from all over the world. The sport is now a global phenomenon, and it all started in Leicester.
Condé Nast Traveller and BBC News Online's covered us, and the local papers have covered us. And
dude, they're celebrities. Yeah.
Ever since I met Steam, and he explained the kind of the art and the beauty of it, as well as the extreme sports side. And,
extreme.
He was just going on and about, and I honestly just didn't think to even ask, what is this, all this all about? And
girlfriend Short Fuse have obtained.
I am a little bit nervous. It's very windy, and I've now got to go and rescue Basket and give him some laundry, which isn't something I'd anticipated. So I'll just go off the edge and we'll see how it goes.
Wait. What?
Don't ironing can be dangerous even in the domestic environment, but in circumstances like this, it is often necessary to take special precautions.
Task is here today is to look after the county people come down abseiling to make sure they don't hurt themselves. just in case. Yeah.
Just imagine, you're a cop, and they're like, hey, yo, okay, so we got some people. They're gonna do some extreme ironing. They're gonna iron while hanging from a very high tower. Could you make sure that they're safe? Then you're like, what? Sure, I gotta watch some people iron in a high place? Why? I mean, hey, yo, it's the easiest day, and you get to watch something ridiculous that you'd never think you'd see.
I've done this duty before, and as of yet, I'm glad to say no one's hurt himself.
And but you're also to look after the extreme ironers.
Yes, so in case he burns himself on the iron, or hopefully nothing like that happens.
Now this is extreme. This is what I call extreme iron. And that dude's
as
iron
the
board says extreme.
It has been revealed
oh
by
goodness.
The Germans that the teams
dude,
will be judged
is
not only on extremity, but also the quality of their
you never
ironing.
Stop.
So it's
can't
vital
stop,
that the British
stop.
Squad is prepared with the right technical equipment.
The iron is the important piece of equipment for the
it
event.
Is.
Obviously, otherwise, you know, we wouldn't be able to
I need the Stanley steamer.
It. I really I like this it. One because it's quite weighty. And
you know what? That one does seem standard. A lot of people have that standard iron. It seems very, it seems like it's the sponsor of Extreme Iron. Yeah, I might have to buy one
British
of those.
Squad has secured a sponsorship deal and a lot of free irons from Rowenta. But will
so
you
what did I say? What did I say? I said it as a joke and then it
so
was real.
Family DM900 Professional Laser is a high range.
Man, this sport is so big
so we are sure
that they
we
have
an
official
well
sponsor.
Hard conditions.
And why has this one been selected specifically to for Team GB for the competition?
Yeah, you see, this is a professional iron.
For professional use?
No, for domestic use, but it's a professional performance.
You know what, though? If you were a company that made, like, irons, like, you would hop on this as quick as you can. Because you're like, A, it's ridiculous, and B, if people actually watched it and saw the extreme ironers using these ironing tools, they would want to buy it because they're like, oh, then that has to be good because it's good in extreme conditions. And they're actually seeing real people use it, not just dumb ads. Next, we got to get some extreme vacuuming going, some extreme
UL
dishwashing,
so we
extreme
test the iron. When they fall
trash
down, how stable they are, and we
trash
can make sure that they are stable when they fall down, and they can completely be used again.
See, you know what? They think that's extreme. But, I mean, come on. That's bitch boy height. That's not extreme height. Extreme height would be if they went to the top of that building,
and then dropped it. That's extreme ironing right there. That's what I call extreme. That's bitch boy, like, you're just starting out the iron height. They're not with the big boys yet. Twice. Why are they walking with vacuums?
But all is not well in the world of domestic adventure sports. Oh. 6 months ago, a group of extreme ironists from Manchester called Urban Housework became fed up with ironing, and so, in this coffee shop, a new white goods sport was invented.
There's beef between the extreme ironers and the fucking extreme vacuumers. Oh my. Who would have thought? Who would have thought that this... It's a turf war now. It's a turf war in the land of Britain. Holy, who would have thought? Who would have thought? Oh my. The domestic sports are all at war. They're probably doing a little, like, West Side story, like... Yo, what you doing on my turf, dog? What you doing? Yo, get that vacuum out... Get that vacuum out of my face. I got this iron. I got this iron. I'm about to fucking iron your face off, dog. I was about to say for the vacuum, guys. I'm about to suck you off.
Several years, really, since Sussex Open. And this is where the original concept was born.
There is only so far you can go with an ironing board and an iron.
But they're right. There's only so far. The vacuum can go first.
And the one with vacuum cleaning appealed most because it was the richest tapestry to play with.
It took it away from just doing the housework outside and took it to more of a sporting level, really. It required skill.
Shit, who would have known that the vacuum can go further than the ironing board? Oh my Jesus Christ. Who knew I would land on a gold mine? Just right here. Benito, learn less about receiving it though.
So how it came to those who always said bread. Dude, that's extreme.
War has broken out between the two groups.
War.
Urban Housework has decided to boycott Munich and organize its own world championship in extreme vacuum cleaning. They've decided to hold the event in Manchester, but how big do they expect it to be?
Definitely not as big as the Commonwealth Games.
Oh my goodness.
If that's not as big as the Commonwealth
vacuum
Games,
you're trying to go all the way.
I feel like
ironing just gets more extreme. These guys, they ain't pushing it to that next level. They're getting there. They went from domestic to
extreme sport.
To like apprentice status. Like they're getting extreme ironing just already at that next level that vacuuming just can't get to right now.
But I am expecting the quality.
Like ironing, you just need the ironing board and then the
extreme vacuum.
Which ironing board's the biggest thing you need.
The
iron's small.
You take
the vacuum's
iron,
a big tool.
You don't actually.
I don't know how you're gonna carry a big tool
all,
upside down on the mountainside. What are you gonna vacuum? With the ironing board,
really
that's your surface.
I just don't
and you're taking your surface anywhere you can
as,
go.
As appealing or as sort of fundamentally right as ironing.
Certainly, they haven't got the sort of sponsorship and backing that we've been fortunate to have.
Are these guys really beefing that hard? They're like, I mean, yo, extreme vacuuming. They ain't got the sponsors we got. We got the sponsors. Extreme ironing, they ain't got it yet. Oh my goodness. This is... It's too good. Oh my goodness. I gotta come back to this next time. I'm gonna end it here. Next time, I was actually gonna play a video game, but next time, we're gonna continue the war between extreme ironing and extreme vacuuming. We gotta get more of this lore. It's a lot going on in this documentary. I was clicking on this just to skip around, but dude, this is a big turf war. I mean, what side are you on? You on the side of extreme vacuuming or extreme ironing? I mean, yo. I mean, we gotta see which one prevails. Gotta see how far extreme vacuuming goes. And we're gonna go down this rabbit hole even more. We're gonna find what juicy details lie there. But okay, anyways, thank you guys. I know that there are a lot of technical difficulties, but hopefully I'll see y'all next time. Anyone who watched at any point during the stream, I very much appreciate it. Anyone that's watching the VOD or watching on YouTube, I also very much appreciate that. And also, yo, give a follow if you want to. Only if you want to, though. You don't have to. But hopefully I'll see y'all next time. Bye. Bye. I'm ready to watch some more extreme vacuuming and ironing.